Good afternoon, everybody. I see the participant number climbing up. We're so excited to have you today. Hello, my name is Mitali Chakraborty. I am the Chief of Staff to AnitaBee.org CEO Brenda Wilkerson, and I will be your hostess with the mostest, asking you some questions. I'm coming to you live from Atlanta, Georgia. What I would love to see in the chat is the response to the following questions. Where are you coming from? On a scale of 1 to 2, my hair is on fire. How are you feeling? And also, if this is your first time joining one of our webinars, let us know by yes or no. So where are you from? How are you feeling? 1 to 10 being your hair on fire. And 3, is this the first time you've joined us? Our hashtag today is #AnitaBeeElevates. So if you are also planning to tweet out some amazing quotes from our panelists today, please use that hashtag and we'll be sure to reshare. I see folks coming in from Florida and Colorado and New Jersey and Virginia. This is amazing. Today's topic is one that came up on every single one of our webinars in our previous series. So we're so excited to talk to you today about how everybody is feeling and coping during these crazy pandemic times. We have some amazing panelists and our fantastic moderator, CEO and president of AnitaBee.org, live from Chicago, Illinois, Miss Brenda Darden Wilkerson. Over to you, Brenda.
Okay. Hello. Thank you so much for that, Mitali. Hi, everyone. I'm so glad to see everybody joining. I see our numbers are still going up. As Mitali said, this is such an important topic. It came up in every last one of our other webinars. I am so excited today to really dig in and get into some important information that we know will help everyone. So I just want to say welcome to this first webinar in our newest series at AnitaBee.org called Elevating Conversations. In our last series, we dissected a wide range of topics, including the role of entrepreneurs and small businesses in remaking our post-COVID world, the combined power of public and private sector together, and the current reality that students are facing. Based on your feedback, we saw an important opportunity to do even more. At AnitaBee.org, our power is sourced from our global community coming together. In this new series, we are seeking to provide our community with the advice, tools, and access to experts that they will need to navigate these uncertain times. To kick us off, in today's session, we're turning our attention to one of the most critical components of surviving the pandemic, while elevating productivity and creativity, which is mental health and well-being. Right now, our sense of normalcy and the safety that we felt before is in flux, which can cause added anxiety, strain, and stress, not only physically and financially, but mentally. Gratefully, many companies are starting to get more in touch with supporting their teams in new critical ways, one of which is acknowledging the importance of managing mental health in a professional setting, especially against the backdrop of being productive and creative. And support and feeling supportive. It's critical to keep this momentum going and to continue to have the conversations that truly matter by coming together, supporting one another, as well as ourselves in smart and strategic ways for the future. I am excited to get to today's discussion with 3 mental health pioneers to discuss ways in which caring for our mental health through uncertain times can influence a technologist's capacity to do great work and take care of oneself outside of the workplace. The goal of our discussion today is to help each and every one of you. We want to be able to take away actionable strategies for ourselves, your toolkit, as well as others around you. And as part of our discussion today, I want to encourage all of us to think about what we can do to address the existing gaps within the tech ecosystem in order to reshape the world's model for addressing mental health in the workplace, especially against the backdrop of women being historically dismissed as overly emotional. On that note, I'd like to introduce our panel. First, we have Jaime-Alexis Fowler. Jaime is the founder and executive director of Empower Work, which is a national nonprofit on a mission to build healthier, more equitable workplaces. Empower Work's confidential immediate SMS hotline is the first for workers, blending emotional and tactical support for workers at critical moments. She's a seasoned leader with a track record of building agile, high-performing, and healthy teams. Next, we have Dr. Christina Villarreal, Advanced Certified Personal and Executive Coach. For more than a decade, Dr. Villarreal has coached top-tier organizational leaders across the Bay Area's diverse tech community through high-stakes tech transitions and challenges in both their work and life. She is a professor at the University of California, Berkeley, and Hope International Business School, teaching psychology and leadership. And next we have Ananya Cleetus. She's the founder of Anemone. Ananya is a rising senior in computer science at the University of Illinois, Urbana-Champaign. As someone who has struggled with mental illness for most of her life, she understands the importance of digital tools to manage mental health. Anemone is the world's first complete crisis app for people experiencing mental health emergencies. She is also a member of the Mental Health America Collegiate Mental Health Innovation Council and has given a TEDx UIUC talk about her personal journey as a college student with mental illness. Welcome, panelists. Let's get into it. So I want to first start with Jaime-Alexis. Can you tell us about yourself and about your work, please?
Absolutely. Well, thanks so much for this great discussion. I'm really excited about this. And hello from San Francisco. I'm excited to chat today because we see the stress and strain that this is causing for workers across the United States through conversations that we're supporting with Empower Work. So to echo, Brenda, what you shared, Empower Work is a national organization, and we provide essentially a crisis text line for workers. And we see the intersection of mental health and, to your point, productivity, a sense of strength or confidence that comes into our workplaces. And of course, it's normal, especially right now with COVID, to have questions. Like, it's normal to not be okay at this moment because we are in uncharted and unprecedented territory. So I'm looking forward to this conversation and sharing some tools and resources with folks and talking a little bit about the data and trends that we're seeing with Empower Work as well.
Yeah, very important thing that you said. It's okay to not be okay right now. And I think especially for high performers and people who are perfectionists, that's a hard pill to swallow sometimes. And so that's a really important first step. So thank you for that. Looking forward to this conversation. Okay, Christina, can you tell us about yourself as well and how you're doing and your company's main mission right now?
So I'm doing well. So my work focuses on working with entrepreneurs and middle stage and high stage executives across the tech ecosystem. A lot of what people are experiencing are new decisions that they're making for the first time. So hiring sight unseen, role changes, and a lot of people making tough decisions. And so part of that work that I'm doing with them is encouraging them to really practice active communication so that their intentions are clear in a setting where a lot of the small nonverbals get lost. All of us are communicating by video. And so everyone communicating in this new way and really helping them in uncharted territory.
That's really important to think about, you know, the visual cues that we just aren't getting because we only see this much of our body, or maybe sometimes people aren't even on video, right? So that's really critical. I'm excited to hear more about that. So thank you.
Thank you.
And Ananya, so first of all, congratulations on creating your new product. Can you tell us about yourself as well and your company's main mission right now?
Yeah, first off, thanks so much for having me, Brenda. I'm so excited to be a part of this conversation as well. And sort of like what you said, Anemone is focused a lot on mental health crises specifically, which I think is probably one of the most difficult topics, even within mental health. And it's something that I've noticed, especially as a student at the collegiate level, is not something that students have any experience with. You know, as we grow up, we learn how to handle physical emergencies. A lot of people know about CPR, stop, drop, and roll. You know, all these sort of things are drilled into us as kids, but you'd be surprised how many people have no idea what to do in a mental health emergency. And I think it's definitely a growing concern, especially among youth. And so I'm really excited to be here and to share the mission of preparing for mental health crises.
Great point. I mean, I love it. You know, I think we know all of these things under the surface, but we don't have them right at our fingertips to help us solve the problems that we find ourselves in with these challenges, right? So I think that's why this conversation is so important and timely. So thank you for that. So Christina, when you're offering guidance to leaders, how do you integrate talking about mental health into the discussion, you know, in a natural way, especially since it's traditionally considered taboo or uncomfortable?
Sure. So for leaders who are looking and paying close attention to their mental health, a big part of tracking how they're doing, the ups and downs, is critical to their performance. It's critical to how they're leading teams with their authentic self. And it allows them to look closely at how they're responding to hard conversations, high stakes decision making, knowing that it's a marathon for them by constantly pushing, you know, working long hours and not engaging in self-care. Their overall performance, they'll eventually start to see some of that come down. And so part of what I'm doing really is encouraging people to pay close attention, engage in self-care, and allow themselves some space, especially during these current times, to not perform exactly as they were prior to the pandemic.
That's really critical. I mean, and it's critical for all of us, right? I, you know, even as I am with sheltering with my children, who are, you know, basically adults, they're college kids between 18 and older, and really just trying to maintain some sort of routine that's different from what they expected, and being okay with that has been a big part of our conversation in maintaining an emotional space where they can thrive. So I'm taking notes here. I just want everybody to know everything that you're saying is feeding me. So it's awesome, and thank you so much. So Ananya, so with Anemone, which is the world's first complete crisis app for people experiencing mental health emergencies, tell us how you realized that digital tools and technology could improve people's mental health, and what are the ways that people can use tech to help themselves?
Yeah, I think, you know, technology gets such a bad rep, but I think it can be such a useful tool for managing mental health, especially for people who are having difficulty, whether it's, you know, tracking habits, tracking moods, mindfulness, teletherapy, even now, you know, mental health crisis management. I think there are a lot of really good tools that people can use. And especially now, you know, with everything going on than the pandemic, I think it's even more important to leverage the technology, not only to maintain that sort of socialization that you would normally have, and finding a way to find that replacement, whether it's social media, whether it's, you know, Zoom, video calls, but also just being more proactive in keeping track of how you're feeling, how your moods are, how your sleep are. If you are involved in meditation, you know, that sort of thing. There are a lot of really good tools out there, I think, especially mobile apps. And so I think it's really, really important to use those right now.
So I just want to, you know, touch on one thing you said about technology. You're using technology to solve a real problem. And so that is an amazing use, the best use in my mind of technology. So, you know, congratulations for that. Okay, so I want to throw this out to everyone. I'd love to start with you, Jaime-Alexis. How are you taking care of yourself through the pandemic? And how do you frame your outlook for the future in terms of maybe habits that you might recommend to our audience?
Absolutely, and it's tough. And I would say, you know, to your, I think, Brenda, when you're mentioning you're trying to maintain, you know, some sense of like schedule and normalcy, I think for each person, it's gonna be really individual. And what works, you know, what's worked prior to COVID may work really well for you, and it may not. And I know for me, personally, I've had to adjust some of the habits and approaches that I've done in the past. So for example, I've always been a morning workout person. Like for me, my day really starts with like I need to get outside. I want to get fresh air. That's a really big, important piece for me for well-being overall. But I'm so much more tired in the mornings now with COVID. And my schedule has shifted in different ways. And so at first I found myself being really hard on myself about that. Like, no, you just got to like get up and like power through it. And now I'm realizing, well, I actually need to adjust and address that in some way. So instead now, you know, I'm still doing some morning workouts, but I'm also doing a walk at 5, you know, with my 4.5-year-old. And so we either go biking or we go for a walk, and it's a way to help disconnect from some of the aspects of work. It's a way to kind of get some fresh air and reset. And I've also started a morning practice of doing kind of like some deep breaths right when I wake up to set some intentions for the day. And I used to do that at a different point, but I realized like I have to do it before I get out of bed. And that's really shifted. And I would say the third thing is getting into a regular practice with myself. And I talk with folks about this, about grace and space, that in this unprecedented time, allowing the grace and space for ourselves and for others around us, that what may work for us, you know, at 9 a.m. this morning may not be working for us at 4 in the afternoon. What's working for us one day might not be the next day. And it's okay for that, you know, it's okay to not be okay. And it's okay to shift that and adjust. And, you know, Christina's great point earlier about, hey, doing that check-in with yourself, like, where are you? And whether it's, you know, logging it in an app or just doing a few moments of self-reflection, checking in with yourself, I found really important. And the last piece that I'll mention is that connection has always been really important for me. And I've done that in the past with, you know, doing regular founder coffees every week where I meet with another founder and we hash through challenges together. And I've tried to shift some of those practices, whether it's like texting and checking in with someone or setting up like a walk and talk. And I've started doing those at like 2 or 3 in the afternoon where I have a meeting where we're just on the phone, no screens, and, you know, and doing it outside, which I found has also been really helpful for me. But that's just for me. It's what's helpful, you know, because of what I know about myself. And so I would encourage anybody, as you're doing that self-check-in, of like doing that assessment of what's working, what's not working, based on what you know works or doesn't work for you. And then making changes and allowing yourself the grace and space to adjust as needed.
So important, that grace part, right? Especially for some of us as women, we want to be perfectionists. We have to be on all the time. It's so important now to give yourself a break and understand that what you need is different, maybe even now. So, yeah. So, anybody else want to take a stab at that one?
I think, you know, like Christina mentioned earlier, the self-compassion piece I think is really, really important. And I think especially in the context of productivity, sometimes it feels like the world hasn't changed because, you know, you still have work deadlines. If you're in school, there's still homework, there's still exams. But I think it's really, really important to be more forgiving and be more kind to yourself, because it really is such a crazy time outside in the world and it's affecting everyone, you know. And so being more aware of that and taking more time, you know, like Jaime-Alexis said, to be there for yourself, check in with yourself, I think is so key right now. And then I think the other thing is also just trying to be more realistic about it, because especially, you know, if you go on social media, you go on Instagram, everyone's doing those 30-day workouts or they're baking all the time. And it seems like this glamorous thing that it really isn't for a lot of people. And I think quarantine can actually be really, really difficult, not only in finding that stability in your daily life, but finding ways to be productive, to balance family, to balance all these things. So I think it's important just to be realistic and just to be compassionate towards yourself and others.
Excellent suggestion. Christina, anything?
I think the one thing that I would add to that is I love the idea of identifying what restorative habits can be helpful to you that might be new. So for a lot of us, our routines have been completely changed. What used to be our go-to to reset now may not be available to us. And so allowing yourself that flexibility to identify new things that help you reset and re-engage as you're dealing with, you know, screen fatigue, isolation, you know, multitasking, as you mentioned. So I think that's one way to continue to cope with the changes.
Absolutely. You know, figuring out, in a real sense, it's an opportunity for us to really re-engage with ourselves in ways that we weren't when we were racing around, right? We didn't have to. And now it's you know, it's stressful that we're doing it, but it really is a great opportunity. So thank you. So can anyone speak to, and I know you can, but to the importance of talking about mental health in the workplace? How can this be done in a way that is productive, but doesn't make other people uncomfortable?
Christina, you're gonna chime in. I was like, who goes first? I would just add, I think in terms of framing there to your question, Brenda, the question of like, what do we think of when we think of mental health? Because when I think about it, I think about it as well-being. And I think that is a conversation that everyone can get behind. How are we all doing well in our workplace? And how do we have the support to thrive? And I think where there become challenges around that conversation, and certainly as you alluded to in your opening remarks around stigma or other challenges, and we start thinking about aspects when our mental health is not okay, when we need to ask for help, when we need to tap into resources, when we need to check in with a colleague or a manager and say, you know, look, I need to have a conversation about something that's not working. That's where it gets more challenging. So I think starting from baseline of, we all need this. We all need to be mentally well. And that mental wellness, mental health, doesn't stop when you walk into the door or, as the case may be right now, start your work computer. That there's not some disconnect between our well-being outside of work and our well-being inside of work. And so setting up structures that work across those and recognizing that we are all human, we are all coming in with different states of well-being, and that's okay. And recognizing too that it can be a challenge to broach those. And depending on where folks are in the workplace, what structures and support that they have, people may have different levels of comfort in raising concerns that exist. And we see that a lot, you know, with Empower Work, about 40% of the folks that we support are lower income, often in workplaces that are not providing things like EAPs or coaches or access to mental health resources. And so the challenge of that is then it feels less safe, and understandably so, to raise those types of conversations. And so if you're in a situation where you feel like I can't, I don't trust my working environment, or I feel unsafe, you know, raising these, I would say one of the best places to start is reaching out to a trusted resource, whether it's a peer, someone who's outside of your company, a friend, someone in your network, someone from a community like this, or a resource like Empower Work, to talk through, hey, how could I raise this? You know, I have a concern, let's say, about my well-being related to COVID. I'm really stressed, and I'm reaching a point where I can't work effectively, but I don't know how to raise this with my manager. Having a conversation in a space that you can really unlock what's going on and talk through a game plan can be really powerful. So sorry, Christina, I don't want to pass it over to you.
Sure. No, you mentioned so many things that I completely agree with. So I appreciate that. I think what I would add is touching upon the issue of safety and discussing mental health in a workplace can be a very delicate subject. And so with an employee speaking to a manager or superior, one way to discuss, choices or flexibility with regards to work style or performance is to share where there's agreement around how the work is connected to the mission of the organization, and agreed upon clarity around what the role is, and then discussing from there how to integrate possible work differences that may be better suited to a person's best working style. In order to allow them to continue to be efficient, but also allow them to pay close attention to, changes in energy and best practices that suit them uniquely.
Yeah, and Ananya, I would love to hear you talk about how this could work in academia and how mental health, addressing mental health issues in academia can be beneficial to students.
Yeah, I think this is, honestly, a really important topic, and similar to addressing it in the workplace, I think the idea of boundaries is something that's really, really important. And that's something that's way more structured normally. Like, you get out of work, you drive home, or in school, you go back to wherever you live, you leave class, but now those lines have gotten, I think, a little blurred. So being able to advocate for yourself and your own boundaries, I think, is especially important. And then on the flip side of that, I think from the university perspective or the faculty perspective is just being a compassionate supporter. Because, you know, students are going through a wide variety of issues. A lot of people have trouble expressing their needs with their family or depending on their living situation. And so I think providing that secondary support system is so important for universities to do for students, especially because, you know, at my age and the age of most college students, this is also the age of early onset of symptoms for a lot of, you know, mental health diagnoses. And a lot of people are struggling, whether it's related to stigma from their community or their background, whether it's just having difficulty expressing their needs. So I think it's sort of a two-way thing, being able to advocate for yourself and then receiving that support from educators and universities.
Yeah, I'm really trying to be encouraged by the attention that is being brought to all of this right now, even though it's coming out of a wealth of challenges that people are having. I'm not happy about that, right? But to really be able to normalize this conversation and for people to be able to reach help, you know, as you said, Ananya, if you have the beginning of symptoms and you're able to go ahead and seek out and get that way of getting support, it's so much better than waiting until it is truly an emergency, right? So more conversations like this, I think, are going to be necessary. So I'm going to get to something a little controversial. I can't wait, actually, to hear what you guys to dig into this, because we know historically, when we talk about women's mental health, even their physical health, it's always been stigmatized in certain circles. Discredited, dismissed as being, oh, you're just emotional, whatever that means. And we know that sub-communities of women actually suffer from this, the stigma is even stronger, namely women of color, the LGBTQIA plus community. So how can we combat this, both at an individual level and at the industry level or company level? Anybody can start.
I'll go ahead and start. That's definitely something that I address with a fairly high frequency, working with women leaders in tech. Many of them are in male-dominated work environments. And so, you know, there may be some of that labeling of being, more expressive of emotion. And one thing that I like to do is to help women and other, you know, and men as well, to reframe that their understanding of emotional expression. Our emotions are powerful in that they bring our attention to things that, if left unaddressed, can lead to more conflict, can lead to, you know, unspoken problems that otherwise might go unnoticed. And so allowing the emotions to be a powerful resource, and becoming more comfortable with addressing and paying attention to people's emotions so that, you know, problems that can crop up are addressed full on and they're informed by that emotion.
Absolutely. I agree.
Sammy, you want to add something?
I agree with I love the power of that reframing, and Christina, your point about the range of emotions and how that shows up. I mean, as you were saying, being attuned to that helps provide really important information. And so that's something that can be really, really powerful. And I think we're starting to see, Brenda, to your point, a real shift. I think this collective, really truly lack of a social safety net that we are really experiencing together in an unprecedented way has helped open up conversations that previously maybe had been harder to have. And so now we're having conversations about, look, I'm not only stressed because I'm worried about the health and safety of my family because of COVID, but I'm also a parent who's navigating not having kids in school, right? And these are conversations that may not have happened before because of stigma. So for instance, a working mom in tech may not have disclosed challenges around childcare previously because being in a male-dominated industry where there's stigma around that, or potentially disclosing that you're going to a therapy appointment and therefore, you know, can't make that meeting. And now we're, I think, at a point where we have to have more flexibility, we have to have more conversations. So I think, Brenda, to your question of like, how do we change that individually and systemically? is a big one, you know, and individually, I would say, you know, we can all show up for others. And Ananya's beautiful articulation of that, as a, you know, compassionate supporter, we can show up for the people in our lives and create the space to say, it's okay to get vulnerable. It's okay to have emotion. What is that emotion teaching us, and how can we show up? And whether that's with folks that we're managing, folks who are part of our team, folks that we care about who are maybe working in a, in another area that may not have as much support as we do. So I think from an individual level, there are ways to show up there. There are also ways, and again, this depends on privilege, power, where you are in a situation. But for example, when I was breastfeeding, and there's a lot of stigma around breastfeeding, I would put it on my calendar, like that I'm feeding Finn, you know, or if I was going to a therapy appointment, I would put it on my calendar. It was like, I'm out of the office, but I had the privilege to do that because I knew that I was in a position of power where I could normalize that experience for others. Not everyone may be in that situation. I think from a systemic level, when we're thinking about company policies, company support resources, I've seen some great examples of companies normalizing providing mental health support. And so saying, you know, whether that's providing EAPs, which are pretty traditional, or getting creative and saying, you know, in light of COVID, we're going to provide, you know, 5 extra therapy sessions to everyone in the organization. And normalizing that from a leadership level and saying, hey, this is something that we all want to provide. We know that this is impacting folks, and we're going to create a policy and an expectation around that. And it could also include things like shifting work schedules or acknowledgement that people may be working different hours, you know, whether it's because of the stress and strain that people are experiencing, and recognizing that no one's going to be 100% right now, or acknowledging that people have different constraints. You may be taking care of elderly parents that you had care for before that you don't. You may be managing childcare in different ways. There are all these different elements of balance. And I hope from a longer policy perspective that as a country, and thinking about the country of the United States, I know we have some folks who are outside of the United States as well, that we're gonna rethink some of the policies that we have at the national level, whether it's paid family leave, which we know, you know, a lack of impacts mental health, or things like paid sick time off so that people could take days off to reset and care for themselves. We see so many situations right now with Empower Work where people are not getting the time and space off to deal with what they're managing right now. And that's incredibly stressful. And I think to Ananya's point about the boundaries really shifting, it's harder to turn things off right now than ever. And so what are the ways in which people can reset? Not having paid time off or not being able to access vacation has really shifted that. And that's been a, you know, that's been really hard for Americans before COVID. And it's, I think, really come to a head in what we're seeing over the past couple of months.
Absolutely. Yeah. Go ahead, Nan. Go ahead.
No, I was going to say, I'm really glad you asked this question because I think stigma is by far one of the biggest issues in talking about mental health. And it's something that I face not only as a woman, but also as a person of color. And especially in like the Indian American community, I think mental health is such a stigmatized topic. And it's something that when I was initially talking to my family about, I definitely felt a lot of guilt, a lot of shame, and even talking about this sort of thing. And I think something that I found to be really helpful is thinking of mental health as sort of this part of the puzzle. It's not this separate thing. It's part of this holistic look at personal health. And I think exactly like Jaime-Alexis said, I think the pandemic has sort of brought that more into the forefront, that not only do we need to be mindful of our physical health, but also our mental health and the way those two are sort of connected. So I think that's something that is especially important to remember, is that mental health is not this separate thing. It's such a core part of being well and feeling okay, especially in quarantine.
And I think, you know, to go along with that, I mean, all these things are amazing that you guys are sharing. To go along with that, to Jaime-Alexis's point about policy changing, we have an opportunity now that there's focus on all of this, that there's a holistic health of people in general, right? And they bring it to work and we need to care about it. And so we have an opportunity to address things in a way that we haven't in the past. And hopefully that's a silver lining that will come out of all of this, especially as we are able to actually leverage some of the tools that you guys are sharing. So all excellent responses. So to go along with all of this, I'd love to hear each of you address how mental health is tied directly to productivity and ways of thinking. You know, it seems inherently, well, yeah, of course they go together, but can you really help our audience understand and be able to articulate it so that not only they understand it for other people, but they understand what's happening to themselves when their productivity perhaps is impacted by how they're feeling? So how about you start, Ananya, go right ahead.
Yeah, I think part of the important thing is to honestly almost deprioritize productivity. Like, I understand that it's important, but it's not the most important thing. And I think sometimes, you know, as a society, especially in the workforce, we tend to glorify being super productive and glorify, you know, slaving over work, not sleeping. All those things are sometimes viewed as good things. And especially I know at the collegiate level, it's almost this toxic mentality of, oh, the less sleep you get, the more you're working, the more you're grinding through things. And I think that's a, you know, really unrealistic expectation. And especially in the pandemic, you know, just being mindful of the fact that, yes, everything is different now. Your lifestyle is different. Your work habits are different. Your sleep cycle is different. And just remembering that, honestly, I think people are most productive when they find that balance in their life and they take breaks, whether it's going outside for a walk, whether it's socializing, talking to friends, cooking, you know, whatever they enjoy. And productivity really isn't just working as much as you can, as fast as you can. I think that's such an unrealistic expectation that people have set.
Absolutely. We needed a reset on that anyway. And so I think that's another silver lining to come out of all of this. What about you, Jaime-Alexis?
I was going to say, I was just going like 100%. And I think I joked on Twitter a couple weeks ago. I was like, if I get another tweet or email or something about like ways to be productive in the pandemic, I'm going to lose my mind because this is not, you know, it's important. And I think part of the pressure that stems from is both that culture of pressure of like, how do you power through it? How do you pick yourself up by your bootstraps? How do you just like work harder, you know, things like that.
Yeah,
that's certainly part of it. I think the other piece of it is that it is real that in an economic downturn, in a situation that we're experiencing right now, there is fear and concern about job loss. And there's research and documented pressure that came out of, you know, the post 9/11 recession, as well as 2008, that folks who are employed, who stay employed or who are engaged, feel this extra pressure to be productive, to be meaningfully engaged in their work, because the risk of job loss is real. And so I do want to acknowledge that pressure, you know, I think the sense of urgency around productivity or feeling engaged can come from a place of real insecurity. And that's a lived truth for many working Americans right now. And I think to Ananya's point, figuring out what are the elements that you need to be successful. And that may be personally changing practices, approaches, addressing your well-being in a different way. It may also be having a real conversation with your employer, your manager, to say, look, what are the standards that I'm being held accountable to right now? So rather than saying like, how do I be more productive, getting really aligned with your team, with your manager around what am I being held to, what's realistic, and how can we make sure that we're on the same page together? So that you don't feel like you're off in a corner, isolated, trying to like just power your way through something that's really, really hard. And that can be difficult. I would also say, going back to that point of like self-check-ins, spending time with yourself each day and saying, you know, is my sense of being off today coming from a place that I need to spend some more time with? So for instance, is there something significant that's happened that I really need to take some time to explore? We have folks who, you know, have lost loved ones with COVID, who are dealing with grief in different ways, who are dealing with processing emotions in different ways. And that may take a different approach in terms of how we're dealing with that and what we want to do going forward. So I think if you see a sense where you're like, hey, you know what, today I was like 80% okay, and I'm okay with that. You know, that's great. And as long as you're aligned with your manager and with your team around what that looks like, and if you're not and you need to do something else, going back to the point of, hey, we can adjust, we can change something, we can shift what we need for going forward, I think is really important.
Yeah, great. How about you, Christina?
Absolutely. Everyone has added really critical things to addressing some of the challenges, the unique challenges that we're facing around productivity. One of the things that I work on with leaders to address challenges that they're having with productivity is to understand where productivity overlaps with procrastination, with and how that overlaps with difficulty with prioritization of work. And so what I will help leaders do is, especially when they're experiencing procrastination, is to help them identify what to prioritize so that what their intentions are, they feel achievable in a unique and identified period of time. And so getting into a cycle of not putting too much on your plate at once, which then can lead to procrastination, but identifying achievable goals that help people get back on track with productivity.
So I guess I just learned why sometimes I procrastinate. Too much on the plate? Okay.
Thank you for that. Sometimes, sure.
I'm learning, boy. Okay, so I'm going to start with you again, Christina. Can you give a key piece of advice to a leader today who might be with us?
Sure. So I think one thing that I think across the board is helpful for people to do is to really be in close touch with what they're experiencing, because more often than not, the people around them that they're working with are experiencing those things as well. So to identify the humanity, to really pay close attention to an empathic response, even when this may have led to bigger problems, you may be needing to give constructive feedback to an employee, but to lead with empathy, and to connect with the fact that while you may be struggling in some ways, the person that you're working with and your team may be struggling in different ways, but in such ways that are equally challenging. And so starting with empathy, rule number one right now.
Yeah. And, you know, again, silver lining. We should always have been exercising empathy, right? So, you know, we're going to come out of this better than we went into it. I'm convinced. So Ananya, what piece of advice would you give a student or even your professors, right? Because professors are people too in the academic community. What kind of advice would you share?
I would say don't be afraid to advocate for your own needs. And I think it's good you brought up the example of professors, because you're right, they're humans too. And even though they're certainly in a leadership role, you know, managing students, managing TAs, staff, you know, they're also going through this just like anyone else. And I think that applies to parents, that applies to leaders in any capacity, people who feel like they have to be a support system for others. I think, you know, even though you may seem like you're the rock for other people, it's okay to be struggling yourself, and it's okay to have needs yourself. And so I think remembering that is super important, that you can be there for other people, but you also need to be mindful of your own needs and how you're doing. So I think, you know, Jaime-Alexis's point about the check-ins is so, so important right now for everyone, regardless of your position or your role professionally in a family. It's super important to check in with yourself and advocate for what you need.
Yeah. Yeah. And Jaime, what would you say to all of our attendees today? What important piece of advice could you give that everybody could use?
I would just say to add to the empathy and advocacy theme is that it's powerful to reach out for help, and vulnerability can be a sign of strength. So I would say, you know, especially right now, we may feel pressure like, you know, so-and-so is really busy because they're overwhelmed with COVID, or I don't want to bring this to my manager's plate, or I'm not sure that I have the right to ask for this. And I would say, it's okay to ask. It's okay to reach out to a resource. I know in the comments, there are a bunch that are being shared, and that's why they're there. You know, we see the self-minimization sometimes that happens when folks reach out to Empower Work. They're like, oh, I don't want to take a peer counselor's time. It's like, that is literally why we're here. You know, like, we are here to be a resource. And so, you know, if you're feeling like you need help, if you feel like something's overwhelming and something's not feeling okay for you, reaching out and looking for a support, whether it's taking advantage of some of these great tools that have been shared, reaching out to a friend and saying, hey, I'm not okay, do you have a few minutes to chat? I think is really, really powerful.
Yeah, that's great. That's great. Well, this has been amazing, and I don't want to stop, but I do want to give our attendees an opportunity to ask any questions that might have shown up in the Q&A. So over to you, Mitali.
Hi, everybody. I was listening intently, and I set an hour aside for tomorrow morning for a little self-care, and I'm going to tell nobody what I'm doing, but just everybody that I work with, that hour is for me. First of all, I just wanted to address that we had a couple of questions that came in of what to do when your manager or director is actually not very supportive about around mental health, like how to even broach that subject when they just don't feel supported. Maybe I'll throw that out to Christina first, and if anybody else wants to answer.
I think that's a very real challenge. And so when you have a manager that's not especially sympathetic, I think the best thing that someone can do is look at long-term, what is the best fit for your role? Of course, right now would be a very difficult time to change roles, but it might just, you know, for some instances be part of the industry where there's just a very high expectation of quick turnaround, a relentless work pace where in which perhaps that industry or this particular organization may not be the best fit. And so to start planning out how to develop a long-term plan for shifting gears in order to allow yourself the space to work in a style that is more complementary to what your mental health needs are.
And I would just add to that long-term view that if something feels immediate, thinking about what's at risk. And you may know this already with how you've developed that relationship with the manager, but maybe what's at the heart of why you feel like you can't trust that person, and seeing if there are other paths to getting support internally. And so that could be, you know, for some folks that could be having a conversation with HR, it could be finding another manager, because I think to Christina's point, thinking about that long-term disconnect is really important, and the immediacy of what you may need right now may need some other additional interventions to make sure that you get what's needed and addressed at the moment.
Amazing, thank you for that. Another question that came in is, you know, these are challenging times, and maybe people are not participating in 30-day challenges and so on, but they really wanna work on developing a kind of a can-do attitude. Thoughts or resources on really how to kind of build yourself up during this time to really go after what you want to go after when you're ready?
I can start. I think my first thought here is to, whenever possible, try to avoid comparing yourself to other people. I think that can be a very demoralizing habit where you see all these other people on social media, or in your workplaces, working at different paces and different ways that can feel intimidating if that's not the right fit for you. So to focus in on what would allow you to feel like you're moving forward towards goals that are unique to you and less focused on like outside goals that may be far less relevant.
Amazing. Thank you. And I have to go to this one question because it just came in after we talked about the non-supportive manager is, you know, Ananya, you touched a lot on stigma. So I'm going to throw this to you first. If anybody else wants to jump in, what if the manager is supportive, but you feel too guilty to get the help? How do you change that attitude within yourself when you have that supportive person and you just don't know where to start or how to really get the help?
You know, honestly, I think this is sort of related to what Christina said earlier about avoiding comparisons. I think too often we get caught up not only in comparisons with other people, but also in comparisons to our past self. And, you know, the reality is there is no normal right now. Normal doesn't exist in the world right now. And frankly, I don't think it ever existed. It's all relative and it's based on, you know, how you work, how you're productive, how you get your energy, what restores you, all that sorts of thing. And I think for a lot of people that's changed. But the important thing, like I said, is just to be compassionate towards yourself. I know that sometimes there's a lot of guilt in asking for help, especially if it's not something you feel like you've needed in the past. But this is such a crazy, difficult time, and it's completely okay to ask for help and to reach out. And if you do have a manager who's supportive, I would say absolutely, if you can, take advantage of having that ally. If you're not comfortable talking to your manager, I think like Jaime-Alexis said, finding someone who could be an outlet or support system, whether that's a peer or someone else, a family member, I think it's really, really important to advocate for yourself. Even if you do feel kind of weird about it, it's, you know, this is such a crazy time. And I think everyone is going through stuff and it may not feel like it when you're alone in your home or sort of isolated from everyone else, but this is definitely not an easy time for anyone.
Thank you, Ananya. Questions coming in about the remote work life, right? So I think we've talked a little bit about just being able to share and have empathy for others. And folks are asking, you know, I'm starting to be more vulnerable with my colleagues. How do I actually set new boundaries now that I'm willing to share more? And also from managers are asking, it's like, how do I set boundaries yet let people know that I'm a human too and not just your boss? So, you know, this vulnerability that we're talking about is scary, but people are jumping in. But then what do those boundaries look like? Maybe Jaime-Alexis and Brenda, if you wanna take this one.
Sure, so I would say, I think the first question I would start with for someone who's thinking about this, and it's a really important question. I mean, as we've talked about, there's so much blurring and grayness that's happened over the past couple of months. It's really what's most important to you. And so I think in thinking about how do I approach that boundary setting, it would be, what are the boundaries that I wanna set? So what, you know, I think starting with that question of like, what do I feel is not working or not comfortable for me right now? And kind of laying that out. And then I think from there, thinking through then, how do I raise this? And it may be a practice that starts with yourself. So it may be saying, you know what, I'm gonna block my calendar at certain times. I'm not gonna be available to be reached out to, and I'm gonna communicate that to the team. That could be one type of boundary. It could be a different type of boundary if you need, for instance, some clear time for childcare or, you know, taking a run for yourself in the afternoon, whatever that might be. And you may not feel as comfortable blocking your calendar, and you may need to check in with someone about that. So I think really starting from that question of like, what boundary is important to me? Where am I feeling uncomfortable? And then how do I approach that and in raising that with someone? I do think we're at this moment of like, people are feeling more connection with the colleagues in certain ways, because we're in this collective experience. And so we do have, I think, a baseline of being able to ask for help in certain ways that we may not have had before.
Yeah, and I think what I would add to that is, you know, especially around the vulnerability piece, I think it's important as a leader to make sure that people understand that you see their humanity. And so you can do that in lots of ways. You can say it, because I think, you know, especially when people are feeling vulnerable and they are feeling challenged, and as everybody mentioned, we all are, things can, you know, you can start to make up things in your head, like nobody cares about me, I'm sitting over here by myself, surely I'm the only one struggling with this. I think someone already shared that. So to be able to, you know, to pepper in to the conversations, you know, how are you doing? I understand this is a challenging time, you know, my door is open. So I think really increasing your ability to communicate about the humanity of people. And again, like I said, this is a silver lining. We should always have done that. I think because it wasn't there, that's why we had that workaholic, work all the time, run, run, run. It was sexy to, you know, be half sleep deprived, right? Because we weren't recognizing the humanity of folks. And so that broadens the, you know, the field for people to say, okay, my manager understands. And even being vulnerable yourself, and, you know, I've shared some of my own challenges, you know, about my kids running around, or, you know, so it's like my kids are everybody's kids. They have kids too. And they understand that I don't care that the kid runs past the screen, you know, I don't react. Right. So I think some of that is a way to bring those boundaries out, to allow folks to be vulnerable about a situation we can't change, right? And then also to bring in the humanity of our lives anyway. We always had kids, families, other things to do, doctor's appointments. Now let's make that normal, right? Let's when we come out of this, whatever that looks like, let's not forget that's the holistic part of being a human. And just because we're struggling now doesn't mean that those won't be still issues when we're out of it. And I just expect that I really do expect we're going to be better because we've been forced to deal with some of these things than we ever were before.
Amazing. I just want to, you know, be conscious of time, but also address the fact that we're all here during a pandemic. And when we go back and look at this webinar from whatever day it is, because what is time? there are differing views of how to deal with this pandemic. And, you know, our nation is divided in many ways, and our nation is divided on how to deal with this pandemic. Any advice to folks on how to talk to people with opposing views? I would say opposing views to a pandemic or non-pandemic, and how to build back better, but also just how to deal with people with opposing views. Like, that takes on a lot of forms. Maybe we'll start with you, Christina.
You know, those are great points. You know, we can, especially now that people are working remotely and organizations are operating on a global level, there may be very different cultural practices and ideologies that make our choices look really different from others. And so one thing that I encourage people to do is to pay close attention to what is under your own control, and what is the space that you can make for other people to create a space for them to operate differently. And so to really identify what's in one's own control and what really should be preserved for other people's choice and difference is one way to minimize the gridlock or conflict that might come up because of those differences.
I love that. And I would just add, when I'm working with folks who have differing views, I often try to instill a practice of getting curious. And so really coming at it with empathy and curiosity to say, you know, it seems like this person's really passionate about this perspective or this viewpoint, and I really want to understand and get curious about what's at stake for them. Why are they holding this so closely in a way that feels really important to them? And I think starting with that sense of curiosity can help build connection, so that you may not come to the same viewpoint. You may be coming from two totally different places. You may be having different experiences around this, but at least you can find some common ground in why you feel so passionately about the perspective that you're coming from.
Go ahead, Ananya.
No, I was gonna say, just to add like another thing to that is, in addition to not being able to control anything else besides yourself, I think you're also the person who knows yourself the best. And regardless of other people's viewpoints or perspectives, at the end of the day, you're the only person on the Zoom call who knows what your day has been like, what your week has been like, what your mental state is. And so I would say just don't get discouraged by other people's perspectives and other people's opinions, especially when it comes to advocating for your own wellness.
Amazing. Before we get to our final question, I just want to throw up on the screen a little call to action. You know, we wouldn't be here today without the hard work of my teammates and Brenda at AnitaB.org. We want to continue to do the work to serve women and women in technology and the workforce. So if you are able, there's a text to give on the screen. And while you're looking at that, you know, I asked you at the beginning of the hour, how are you feeling from one being okay to 10 being my hair is on fire? Before we close out, you know, if you're feeling slightly grateful for all these resources, or if you've learned something new, you know, maybe one word to describe how you're feeling now, put it on the chat. I'd like to thank our teammates, Tasha and Jesse and others who've been capturing those resources. And I just wanted to say how grateful we are to the panelists and Brenda for moderating this today. So just remember to give yourself some space and grace. Those two words I use as often. I heard that if there was a word cloud, I think space and grace come up often. COVID and fear right next to it. So give yourself more space and grace so you live in less fear. But to really close out, what I would love, I think it was you, Christina, who first talked about changing some of your restorative habits because maybe it's not available. I'm going to be honest, ladies, these eyebrows need some work. And I just told all 194 panelists that they need work. But I'm going to sit back like this, and that restorative, you know, option is not available. You know, let's all go around and share with those that are still on for the webinar, you know, what you're doing to take care of yourself, or maybe what hobby you picked up. And it's okay if you didn't, but maybe some advice on what you're doing during these times. So we'll go Christina, Jaime-Alexis, Ananya, and we'll let Brenda close it out. So thank you so much, everybody.
I'm working very hard at adopting a compassionate attitude towards my daily decision-making. There are some days where I'm motivated to do more with regard to, you know, productivity and self-care and organization. And there are other days when I'm just not as focused. And so trying to adopt a compassionate attitude towards myself and saying, you know, tomorrow's a new day allows me to not feel discouraged in that moment when my energy levels are waning.
I would say the self-compassion piece is really important. And for me, that work has been around allowing for joy. I think in really tough moments, it can feel like I can't be joyful right now because there's hardship. There's so much hardship that's happening. And trying to find joyful connection in different ways every day. And thinking about that and what that looks like differently. So that may be like a quick note to someone over text, or it may be like, you know, going around the park with my four-year-old where there was a pianist playing and we just like sat and experienced joy together, socially distanced with masks on, as this, you know, as the pianist played in the park, and being able to sit with that and say, I'm not going to check my phone. I'm going to create the space to really be here in the moment and connect with this joy that's happening and recognize that that is a wonderfully restorative practice. And in some ways, like an act of resistance, that's really important right now.
I would say to sort of add to joy, also gratitude. And that can be for anything. It can be the smallest things, but just, you know, taking a little bit of time to reflect on the things that have gone well, the things that you do have. Because I think that's something that a lot of people take for granted, even before, you know, the pandemic started. And so for me, at least, I think a big one is being back home with my family, maybe not under ideal circumstances, but I've been really grateful to have that time with my parents and my sister, you know, more time to sort of relax, to focus on myself. And so just, I think, focusing on the things that have gone well and the things that you are grateful for, even if that's, you know, basics like stable food, shelter, whatever it is that people may have in their lives, I think it's really important to maintain that attitude.
I'm going to say a here to gratitude, well, to everything everyone has said, but gratitude is, to me, is job number one. You know, we have so much to be thankful for no matter what we are going through. And that is, in many ways, a way, if I'm getting into a funk, that will immediately get me out of it. I also have learned to live more in the moment and not worry so much about the future. When I start worrying about it, I learn to get back in the moment and be grateful for what I'm doing today. But also a habit that I picked up, so I love fiber arts. Normally that was something that I would do that was great therapy for me. And I actually bought a loom and I'm learning how to make rugs because I like to create, and it's, you know, therapy to just to get my hands into something. So, you know, just finding a way to be creative, because I'm very creative. If I can't create one way, I'm going to create another way. And I find that to be helpful to me. But I just want to say, this has been amazing. I love it. Thank you for everything that you shared. You guys are just rock stars. You brought a knowledge to us that we need that's so meaningful for this time. So thank you, panelists, for being with us today. And thank you for everybody that's online. Thank you for sharing your time with us. And I just want to say that before we go, I would like to encourage every member of our audience to draw upon all of the topics that we discussed today, all of the great wealth of information that was shared with you, and commit to something that will support yourself as we look to the future. So again, thank you for joining us for this important conversation. Please stay tuned to our website, to our social media, more conversations coming your way. And whatever you do, please be well and be kind to yourself. Give yourself space. Thank you.